All right, guys, thanks for your patience. Those who are waiting for the live stream, new computer, a couple issues, we're good to go. So super happy to connect with you. Merry Christmas, happy holidays, whatever you celebrate. It's a great time of the year. At least for me, I like to like sort of recap on things and then in a couple days start planning for the new year. So in this conversation, guys, I want to connect with you in a way that I'm not able to in my videos. You know, I can't really go deeper into my thoughts and whatnot. Usually they're around 20, 30 minutes. And I wanted to take the time to answer a lot of your questions. I get a lot of questions in my emails. There are a lot of repetitive questions, more popular questions. I can answer those. And then guys, I want you to shoot out in the chat here. I won't be able to answer everybody, but I want to do my best to answer your questions and just have a nice dialogue, nice relaxed conversation. I'm super excited. I have goosebumps, guys, little goosebumps here because I'm very humbled to be doing this. I'm very humbled to have an audience that wants to see this kind of stuff. And truth be told, with the world we're all in, this is this work I find my sanity in. I find my sanity connecting with people and getting into different lives and showing different stories. And the fact that others are like you are interested in that too and lets me create a living out of this, wow, I'm super grateful. So thank you all for that. Let me hit with a few questions here, guys, from you guys, and then I'll go into some themes. Like I want to talk more about how I started. People always ask me, how'd you start? How did this thing just get going out of nowhere? What was your journey like? How do you find the people that your subjects? How do you get into the situations you get into? Those sorts of things. Okay, Blaze Bob, thank you. You've been with me for forever, since the beginning, I'd like to say. And he asked a great question. What's the end goal, Peter? You know, I don't necessarily have one. I know that's a terrible business model, and I've been trying to think of, you know, more of a better business model in that sense, but I'm just sort of doing what feels right and natural at this point in time. So I have my next year sort of set up, which I'll talk to you guys soon about, different series we're going to get into, different people we're going to connect with. But as far as end goal, like to build a big company with, you know, many people going out into the world and telling stories or something like that. No, I haven't even, nothing's really grabbed me, to be honest. So I feel like I'm still in this, you know, I'm what? 2 years of taking it seriously, I would say. 2 years in of taking it seriously. So I feel like I need to just do and get better at it and build up more of a library and resume before I can take the next step. That's sort of what I focused on. Just like I got to pump a video out to you guys every week, every Sunday. And sometimes that's easier than others. You know, sometimes I'm grinding pretty hard to get that out there because there's a lot of travel involved and whatnot. So Blaze Bob, no end goal right now, but thank you. Thank you for your comments throughout the years. I mean, with a name like that, how could I ever forget? So thank you. Country, Efren Reed asks, what country have you had the best and worst experience? Explain. Thank you. Well, the worst experience, I was poisoned in Uzbekistan back in 2002, and that was pretty bad. But this, just as it got so dark, it got light because these people, this family took me in, and the guy was a doctor and brought me back to life. So that'd probably be my worst. As far as best, it's like so many really good experiences. I don't have one that sticks out. Okay, guys, thanks for the chats up here. Shraggy, we need more videos with Shlomi. Shlomi from the Hasidic series. Yeah, I agree. He's awesome. And Lars, thank you. I appreciate Danish Crones, I believe. Crones. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Okay, P Trader asks a really good question. Will I do videos outside of the U.S. again? Yes, for sure. That obviously got derailed this last year. My wife and I were living in Ukraine, and we were actually going to stay in Europe. Then the pandemic started, And it was like, all right, I sort of tapped out all the content I could out of Ukraine. I think I've done 60 videos there or something. And I just didn't have much more in me for Ukraine. So then we're thinking Europe, and then all these travel bans are starting and this lockdown stuff. So we're like, oh geez, what are we going to do? And it was going to be a move to Italy situation because I have an Italian passport too. And then I was like, I don't even speak Italian. And what am I going to do? Go to tourist sites? You know, I'm sure I could find good stories, but I'll run out of content there. So we came back to the States, back to California. And God, in the 4 years I left, things changed so much in San Francisco. I'm sure you hear me bitching and moaning about it in some of my videos. It's more like a broken heart thing because that was always my favorite place, but it went downhill so bad. I'm like, all right, we're out of here, because it just wasn't safe for my wife when I'd go on trips to get content. Now we're in Florida. Never would have imagined it in a million years. So we're in the States. Back to your original question. Yes, international content. I really hope to get Palestine in Israel. That was on the radar the springtime. What was it, 2020, when the pandemic started? Had to be canceled, obviously. And that's like very strong on the radar. That would be my number one go-to. But I don't know what the story is there in Israel right now. I think it's like 4 boosters or 3. And I'm just waiting for things to chill out a bit, because in my style of shooting, going in with a camera, talking with strangers, you know, I don't want to set and plan everything up. It just sort of changes the vibe of the videos I make. So I want to be quite free, especially in that series. So I need to go in when it's, you know, a bit more open. Hopefully that's soon. So yeah, a lot more international. Now living in Florida, it's like a lot of the world is close. I never even thought of this, but Cuba is literally an hour away. It's really close. And even Colombia is like 3.5 hours away. And here we have the great Shlomi Zionse here in the chats, giving me some props. Thank you, brother. Appreciate it. For those that you know, of you that don't know Shlomi, most of you do, he's a hero, a Hasidic Jew that really has done more for his religion and culture than I think anyone else. He reached out to me and said, you know, Peter, do you want to get into this Hasidic world? And I was like, yeah, I know nothing about you guys. Why not? Sounds like a great idea. And that's how that series started. And that was when I came back to the U.S. right in the beginning. I was born in Vermont. The first 17 years were in Vermont, and my mom still lives there. So my wife and I lived with my mom for about a month. And it's crazy. It wasn't that long ago, but it was a year and a half ago, not even a year and a half ago. And it was like, okay, am I really going to make it with this YouTube thing? Because it was sort of manageable in Ukraine, because my cost of living, I think our rent was $750 a month. Didn't have a car and could live on nothing, basically. And, you know, I could sort of pull it off there, but I'm like, oh, geez, look at how much everything is now in the States. And I had no idea the content would work. So that was sort of like the first big testing ground, doing the Hasidic Jewish series. And then it's just grown a lot since then. So Shlomi, thank you, brother, for bringing me into your world and all of us. I think you guys, it's the Hasidic Jews. Look, it's one of those mysterious cultures, I would say, for most of us. The more mysterious, the more interesting, like the Amish, right? Blaze Bob, welcome to On Board. Welcome to On Board. I'm on board, Bob. Thank you, brother. Appreciate it. Okay, Bread Pitt asks, Peter, what do you think about trying to make some videos on mystic topics, maybe some dark, insidious places, etc., a new format? I don't know about a new format, but I'm totally into mystic topics. Again, like anything that's unknown seems to be more popular and interesting for all of us. So I've had a witch, I don't know if you'd consider that a mystic topic, but a witch reach out to me. I know nothing about witchcraft. I think that would be interesting. I've had some alternative communities reach out, which we're going to be getting into this next year. I want to talk about upcoming series here at the end. but some different alternative communities, more spiritually minded. So yeah, very interested. Any ideas you guys have too, please send them my way. You know, it's a one man band here. It's two men. My wife does a lot of the behind the scenes. You know, she does the teasers and the videos. She helps. She got this live stream going on my new computer that I was getting super frustrated with. So actually, she's the glue that holds it all together. But really, it's just us. So rip off an email, contact@petersantanello.com, you guys, if you have any good suggestions, good, interesting characters. Like the Shlomi of whatever community. That's what we're looking for. Alexandra B, big up, Peter. One love. Thank you, Alexandra B. Appreciate it. Big up. Is that an Aussie term? Big up. I like it. Okay. Jennifer here says Native American reservation would be interesting. So yeah, Jennifer, that's been high on the list for a while. And I started working on it and trying to get into the Navajo Nation. But they tribal, from the research I did, tribal rules, I think a lot of you know this, are different than like normal state or federal law. We're going to learn more about this when I get into these series, how the structure, the governance works. But they were very locked down for COVID, from what I heard. And they're wearing masks outside, from what I've heard. Correct me if I'm wrong, if someone's from the Navajo Nation. But it just looked like, you know, I got to get up close and personal with my camera. And if there's a lot of fear or, you know, distancing going on in a community, it just doesn't work. I'll deliver a terrible video. And if everyone's masked up, it just doesn't work as well. So, yeah, that's happening this year. Hopefully that's definitely going to happen. That's absolutely the number one thing I want to do is Native Americans and getting into different reservations across the country, because they're I believe over 100 of them, and they're very different wherever you go. Harris says, you're more of a true journalist than the lying MSM. Well, thanks, Harris. I don't consider myself a journalist, to be honest. I just consider myself to be a curious person. I think like all of you, you're all curious. You all want to see into a different world or life without some real angled agenda. That's what I'm trying to do. Literally because I'm so sick of the MSM. For those that don't know, mainstream media. Most of you know that, but my mom didn't know that the other day when I said it. So yeah, I mean, the MSM actually fuels, I might come across all nice and you know, happy and jovial, but underneath there's some strife, like most of us, some conflict and some, you know, the resentment comes from the MSM because it's really just dividing us. And coming back into the country after 4 years of being out and seeing just how everything is so angled, it just pisses me off, because I actually see America differently for the first time, despite the weird state the country and the world is in. I'm actually way more appreciative than I've ever been before. You know, I was always appreciative to grow up where I grew up, because I was I could think logically enough to know that, look, it was given a great currency. Well, it's definitely devaluing a bit right now, but still on the world stage, it's a great currency, a passport to go everywhere. The English language, I didn't think about English. I didn't have to learn it. It was downloaded into me, which means you can travel the world. I mean, like so many doors are open, right? And so I knew all that, but I didn't really realize just some things like clean air, you know, like just being around, you know, I can get clean food. You know, there are parts of the world, this stuff doesn't exist. And just the basics. And the fact that things work despite all the weirdness right now, things work pretty well. It's surprising that I can order delivery and it's here in 2 hours. I mean, it's amazing. So what was the original question there? I'm sorry, I got off on a tangent there. Zane, come to Oklahoma. Many different reservations, Native Americans here. Chickasaw Nation is cool. Thanks, Zane. I appreciate the donation to the channel. And yeah, Oklahoma, you know, the heartland, even apart from Native Americans, I'm really interested in the heartland, the Midwest. It's been fascinating. The Michigan trip I did, I'm really sort of liking it. It's the people are, I think they're just a little more old fashioned and more polite. They have more time. It's been nice. So I would like to go to Oklahoma for both reasons. Okay. Do I keep in touch? Not Even Wrong says, do you keep in touch with the Amish families? Yeah, I just talked to Josh the other day. He's doing well. He was Beachy Amish for those that saw the Amish series. He's doing really well. He's a lot of good things happened with that series for him. And I think sometimes when an outside entity like myself or whomever, right, comes in and shows them from a different perspective, they start to feel like, if I'm not going in to like rip them apart, which I'm not, they appreciate what they have more, I think, because we all get used to what we have. And so when someone comes in and confirms something that maybe you know, but you don't think about, it's a positive thing. So yeah, Josh, I got to write to the Schwarzentruber couple. I have their address and I'm looking forward to just, maybe I'll do that in the next couple of days. Write a letter, like a handwritten letter to them, because they're, for those that didn't see the video, the Schwarzentruber Amish are those ones that most of us think of, like off the rails, off of society. Some don't even know who the president is. They are completely removed, like no technology, no electricity. So the guy that I got in with them, I couldn't shoot their faces, but it was still interesting. They made me a hat, and the guy, I'm forgetting his name, but he gave me an address to send a letter to, because it's all he has. So I'll keep in touch with him too. That's what I'm really loving, is just all the variation here coming back. I see it for the first time, because you're in the hoods and that's one reality. You're with the Amish, it's another. The Hasidic, the wealthy neighborhoods in Los Angeles. It's like, how are they all under one country? Because they're all so like very little in common. All right. Jester Boy, Merry Christmas, Peter. Greetings from Kyiv. Thank you for being an inspiration and influence in my life. Love hanging out with you, bro. Thank you. Thank you so much. Love Ukraine. For those that you haven't been, it's a great country because it's a very, despite its geopolitical issues and whatever other issues, the people are amazing. I mean, the people are amazing everywhere, but there are certain places where they like, they're not putting on a show. They don't, they're not, everything's very authentic, let's say. And that's what I've enjoyed too with getting in with the Amish or the, you know, many people, many different groups. They're not really trying to roll out the red carpet. I mean, the Amish, they're all friendly, but I'm just saying, like, they're not trying to push their ways on you. So they're really very authentic experiences. Okay. Just someone just asked me about Cash App or Venmo. God, I got to get Venmo going. I have PayPal. It's in the links of the description of my videos, but thank you. If you want to send to the channel, I think it's pretty much this is similar as with Venmo. Zoroastrian community in Iran. Ordex says, yeah, great. I would love to. Zoroastrianism is very interesting. I would love to. I've been to Iran twice, and I don't know if I can go back right now, to be honest. It was a little heavy last trip. Just with like shooting videos and having microphones, and I'm in this area space where, like, in between travel vlogger and journalist, I'm not like just want to show you the sandwiches I'm eating, and I'm not like an investigative journalist. So I'm in between, and so some nations, they don't know what to categorize you as. So if I go into Iran with, you know, I'm sort of touching deeper cultural things, they might consider it journalism. And then, like my experience last time, which I don't want to speak of completely on camera, I can't. it was a bit heavy, and it was like not with the people there, but with just going as in as an Italian, but growing up in the States, and many factors that, you know, I have a wife and a dog. Okay, where do you get your haircut? Red River, Colorado. Right here, Red River. I'm doing it every morning. I just have like the beard shaver. I just do everything at the same time. Okay, Mensor says, a Bosnian community in St. Louis. Thank you for the donation. I would love to do that. I love Bosnia. I've been to Bosnia. Fantastic country, beautiful country, really little known country. That's an interesting topic for sure. So guys, I'm going to get off on going into a question I get all the time. So I just thought I'd answer it here for everyone to see at once. So the start to my vlogging, and a lot of you have maybe seen, you know, me in the last couple of years, and you know, oh wow, that happened quick. You just start, you know, picked up a camera and got going. Well, no, it didn't happen that quick. I'm not going to give you my full life story because it will take forever. But roughly 10 years ago, my dream for since I was basically 20 years old was to make a travel TV show. I really wanted to show people the world and show people what I saw in the world. I didn't travel out of the country until I was 25 years old. It went around the world for 2 years. I saved $20,000. I worked day and night for 2 years. And at that time, that we're talking early 2000s, $20,000 was, you know, could do something and you could travel for a while. And so I went around the world for 2 years, 50 countries. When I came back from that, I was constantly answering, you know, people's questions about, you know, where'd you like? And I would say things like Kyrgyzstan. And they'd be like, well, why would you go there? I'm like, well, beautiful lake. That's like Lake Issyk-Kul. It's like 10 times the size of Tahoe. People amazing. Kids are like brought up on horses. It's beautiful. It's stunning. Yeah, the politics sucks, but I'm not there for the politics. I'm there for the culture experience. And I realized most people just, we don't have much exposure to most of the world because of the MSM, right? So I thought, well, why not make a channel on these places? So at that time, it was like a little YouTube was cranking at that time. Maybe I was just wasn't up to speed enough. I don't know what I was thinking, but I'm like, okay, I got to make a TV show. And so I was living in Reno. No, I was in Lake Tahoe, California, in Reno, Nevada for about 2 years. I was flying back and forth to Los Angeles to this networking group, like every 2 months. And I was trying to get in, like, I didn't know what I was doing at all. I didn't have any connections. And I was trying to get in with, you know, the industry, right? Meet these production companies and you know, try to get a show live, try to get someone to pick up a show, even though I never did one. I was really, had no clue really what I was doing. And that, I was at that for like 2 years, and I had another business, a less glamorous business, which was detailing cars, boats, and planes. And that's all I wanted to do. My dream was to make a travel TV show, and I would do anything I could to support that. So I knew if I got like a so-called real job somewhere, working in a bank or finance or whatever it might be, and I would be terrible about those jobs, but just a normal job, then I would, it would make it harder for me to reach what I wanted to get. So I did work that I didn't like for a long time. And I want people to know that I did a lot of stuff that was not enjoyable. And I would see other people my age and friends like accelerating in their careers and whatnot in their 20s and early 30s. And I was like, all right, I got this dream that there are zero guarantees in that one. And the TV world, the longer I was trying to pitch this concept, well, eventually just the steel wall, you know, one guy was just like, you know what, man, you're nobody. You have no reputation, no contacts, no background in producing videos. So here's what you got to do, man. You got to do YouTube on your own and then build up something. And it didn't really click with me at that time. I'm like, all right, maybe this travel TV show thing's a bad idea. I'm just like running out of, I put all my money at it. Oh, I forgot to mention, I did shoot a teaser video in the Republic of Georgia. So at the time I bought all this camera equipment when it was way more expensive. I paid for a cameraman to come with me to the Republic of Georgia. I spent all of my savings on this, right? We went over to Georgia and I didn't know what I was doing really, but I'm just like, we're going to get into this thing. And we got into it. Like we got up into this vein in the Caucasus Mountains, Tusheti. And it's like a different world up there. People just like mountain people. And that was at a very unstable time too. Like the Russian MiGs were coming over, bombing Chechen rebels. We're staying in these little houses high up in the mountains. Beautiful, beautiful scenery. Some of the most beautiful in the world. And like, I was just pounding wine out of a horn, like an ox's horn. It was all hollowed out and just getting obliterated that way, trying to make a TV show. And the cameraman, I pretty much destroyed him. And I'm sorry, Brian, if you ever see this, you know, I just like threw him in. He had no international traveling experience and I just threw him in. He was all gung-ho and ready to do it. But we're just like going full days and just, you know, following the party at night and getting up early and, you know, shoot this, shoot that. So that's the teaser. Edited that up, paid an editor because I hate to say it, but I think I was scared to edit. I was scared. I was like, how am I going to do this? I don't know what I'm doing. So I paid someone to edit. It came out to like a 3-minute teaser. You'll see it at the beginning of my channel if you ever want to see it. It's called The Motley Planet. It was the series. And that's the one I pitched in Los Angeles for like 2 years. And no interest, and it went nowhere. And so I'm like, all right, Peter, that dream is, I don't know, maybe there's a better way to achieve your mission of showing everyone that the world is pretty open and amazing. And like, there's all this cool exploration. And so I came up with this app idea that connected. And if someone's super tech savvy and, understands this business model better than I did, maybe it could still work, but it would connect travelers with locals. So if I wanted to say you were a runner or you're into kite surfing, whatever, right? You type in the location. So you're going to go Berlin, your dates and running, and it would match you with that person that likes the same thing. Cause people usually connect through common interests. I want to do a shout out. Andre, thank you so much. Appreciate it. He just gave a nice donation. Appreciate it, man. So it would connect you with a person that likes what you like. And that's usually how people hang out with each other, right? Over common interests. And I always was like, what a great way to travel is like you get to meet the locals and not do the normal stuff and get the local experience. So I went at that for a couple of years. I had Indian development team. I was still running my auto detailing business. I had employees at this time. So I was 1 foot in that world, keeping that going, living in San Francisco, and then full in on this app. And I would be up on Indian time late at night working with these developers. It was like 2 or 3 years. Anyways, I was way over my head. Again, way over my head. Didn't know what I was doing. I love the theory of the concept. It was an amazing, I thought it was an amazing concept. But there are things like Facebook and other companies that can do the online social media thing way better. And I couldn't monetize it. And then it was just great. Like had some things like if you're a heavy metal, you know, guitarist, you can meet another, you know, a heavy metal guitarist in Cairo, Egypt, which they actually do exist there. And it was such a cool thing. I love the idea. I hated the process. Every day, all I was doing was like trying to fix bugs on the website and deal with the Indian development team halfway around the world. And quite often we weren't connecting on communication and whatnot. So it was an absolute nightmare. So that was like midlife crisis number 3 or whatever. And I just remember I had to let that go because I ran out of money. I just couldn't put any more money in it. I couldn't get investment. I was doing these startup things in San Francisco all the time, trying to connect. And it's just, it wasn't my space, to be honest. I mean, I could perhaps lead a team doing that, but to lead a development team and figure out the business model and monetization was a nightmare. And so I bounced out of that. And I could go on and on forever, guys. I won't give you my full life story, but let's say 4 years ago, it was before I sold my detailing business, but I was in Ukraine. I could run it from there. And I was going to start, I'm like, I got to get something else going in life. I'm going to, you know, I'm almost 40 years old. And if I don't get something else going, like, what am I going to do? I need to make some money. And I was going to do an Amazon drop shipping company and also a sales team in Ukraine because the labor is much cheaper and we could do sales or customer service for companies out of the US. My heart wasn't in either of those things. I was just trying to think of something that would work. And then it was like, I had some money saved and I was like, a friend I talked to, he was like, if you really want to learn the language, go live in the countryside with a family. And I was just sort of at this, like, again, midlife crisis point where I'm like, what am I going to, yeah, maybe I'll do that. And so I had an assistant and she hooked it up with this family in the south of Ukraine near Russia. And it was a family that was refugees, basically, from a city right on the border with Russia. And they moved to the countryside inland because their apartment was bombed out. So I moved in with them. It was three kids and two parents. And I said, you know, I'm gonna make a video series out of this. I don't know. I'll put it on YouTube. We'll see what happens. And I did that. And it was 6 weeks with them. It was a grind. I mean, we were like, you know, at nights it was like, what's better? Have the window open and the neighbor's trash burning, their smoke coming in your room. But by having the window open, you just got it down to, like, you know, 82 degrees, which in Celsius, what is that, 30 or something? Or I could close the window and it would get up to 88 degrees and I wouldn't smell as much trash. And so it was a grind, and it was on like some mattress from pre-Soviet times, like from the Romanov dynasty or something. It was just like the springs going into every rib. And but hey, it didn't matter. It was about getting this amazing content. And for me, it was a life transformational experience. I got like a lot of respect for religious people. They were very religious. And the first morning we woke up, and there was a prayer with the family. I'm like, okay, it's Sunday. Gotcha. 30 minutes of praying. Sure. Singing, praying. And then Monday morning came around. It was like the same thing. And then that was 7 days a week. And at first I was like, oh God, I can't, nothing against religion. It's just like, this isn't my thing really. But I got into it with them, not like connecting with the religion, but just into their ceremony. Let's just call it a ceremony because that's what it was. It was like something that binded the family together. And the father was a former drug dealer, street fighter, alcoholic dude. And he found God and he got rid of that life and was raising a very nice, harmonious, beautiful family. And they're so well connected. So at that point in time, I learned, you know what? Religion can really work for some people. And I stopped judging it poorly. I always thought before, why would I follow a book that's, you know, younger than some of the redwood trees in California? That's insanity. Why would I? But now I don't think that anymore. I'm like, okay, that works for them. Those are their beliefs. As long as they're respectful to me, I'm all in. And say then that lesson allowed me to integrate with the Hasidic Jews. You know, before maybe I would have been more judgmental. It's terrible. We want to be less judgmental, but so that was the first series, 6 videos or 7 videos from the Ukrainian countryside. It did pretty well in Ukraine because it was so out of the box. It's actually called Fish Out of Water. And I even sold corn on the beach. It's sort of like this mafiosa beach. And there was like a mafia overlord that controlled corn sales. And I stepped on his turf. it got all funky. It's a good video. You'll see it back in my channel if you want to see that one, selling corn on the beach. But trying to think of different concepts that would work with the underlying goal of like humanizing places and people. So that's how it started. And then I moved back to, you know, went back to Kiev, the capital. And the next series was in Iran, and went in Iran and did a series there, and that did pretty well. But it really didn't start taking off until I got regular, which is, I think, maybe two and a half years ago. I got regular posting every week. And the algorithm in Google, YouTube rewards you more if you're like that. So you got to be regular, and it's just building up an audience. It took time, you know? So getting regular and actually coming back to the States helped a lot, because the ad revenue is much better for the audience here than, say, Ukraine. So now I can, you know, not worry about, well, you never know, the ad revenue is up and down every month, but, you know, I'm living in a much better way financially, because it built up this U.S. audience, and it's just, the U.S. has become all interesting to me now, where it wasn't so much before. I was always interested in the world, and now I'm coming back, and I also feel like it's my antidote to, you know, the craziness that's going on in this world, and like trying to see good in things and get in on the ground level, which is totally different than the online world, or not totally, but a lot different. The perceived reality through the internet of what the world is versus when you're on the streets yourself. And I'm trying to close that gap with these videos for you guys to be like, yeah, okay, Detroit is known as a total hole, but look, actually the downtown's come around and it's quite amazing now. And even in the hoods, there's something good in them. Like there's all sorts of strife and problems, but there's a community, there are people starting businesses, there are people living their lives. And I want to show that and not just do, you know, the media, the MSM shtick and just divide and conquer. That's pretty much the business model. So that's a question I get a lot, guys. Nick from Cali. Nick, thank you for supporting. Nick traveled. We traveled a long time ago in Argentina and Montevideo. That's right. So that's the point, guys, is just to try to create a space online that that just doesn't divide us, you know? And I try not to romanticize. I know my content is mostly positive. I'm not going to go into the Hasidic people and just rip them apart. I just feel like that's 99% of the internet on that group of people. And I do try to mention and say, look, there's an apartment building, and I bet you in one of those apartments, someone's getting beat up, and someone just had a kid, and someone's just having a birthday, and someone has the most harmonious family. And that can be said at any apartment building of scale that you look at. There are all sorts of stories going on at the same time. They're all true. They're all true, but where's the light focusing on, right? And so, you know, I'm not going to meet up with someone like an Amish person and try to rip them apart and look at their worst side. That's why I'm not journalism. The world needs more investigative journalists that are completely bipartisan, that, you know, if they're going to hit a story, they're going to hit it from, say, in one video, right? They're going to hit it from a few different, totally different angles. Like, this is the happy story. This is the danger. This is the blah, blah. And that takes a lot of resources and a lot of time. And if I'm going to survive on YouTube, I have to post once a week. And I can't outsource this stuff, a lot of it. So that's why I'm not a journalist. What I do, guys, is give you an angle in to something that maybe you're not experiencing in your own life. I try to do it as non-biased as possible, which I'm sure my bias comes out at times. It's impossible not to, but I try to like let the subject speak as much as possible. I roll the camera. You guys like it, you dislike it, doesn't matter. It's you, maybe if you get something out of it, that's all I care about. So that's the big question, guy. I mean, that I always get, like, how'd you start doing this? And, you know, did it just happen overnight? No, it's, and I left so many details out there, and I'm 44 now, so I have quite a story at this point. So long journey. It really winded a few different, it got stuck in a cul-de-sac over here doing circles for a while. And then it went on the highway for a bit. And then there was a crash. You know, it was no straight road, that's for sure. So where I'm at now is I'm pretty happy. I'm very hard on myself. Every video I look at is like, oh, I missed that. I didn't do that well enough. I wish it was more interesting in this point, that point. So I'm never totally comfortable in this, to be honest. But the goal is this next year. This year was a big stepping stone, and this next year, super pumped for. Just to bring it to the next level, I think I've gotten a little bit better with how to structure a story. But a lot of it's the spontaneity and the not knowingness, which makes it interesting. So sometimes I get into something and everything might be set up. Like the weather's sunny. The subject, like Shlomi, is fantastic. The subject matter is super interesting. And all these things come together at once and make an amazing video. Or I could get in and the weather comes in bad. It's windy. I'm like constantly trying to block the wind so it doesn't mess the audio. The subject and I are connecting super closely. And the story's not that interesting. And so sometimes I can't avoid it. There's some stuff I don't even post. Because it just doesn't work out for various reasons. But the goal is to get you guys better stories. I feel like I'm getting a little bit better at, like, there's a lot of unknown, but at least packaging it in a way where it's a little bit easier to watch. So that's the goal for this next year. Moon, thank you for reaching out. This has been a fan since day one. A lot of you have been fans for years. So thank you. You supported me from the beginning, Moon, when I had like three people watching my videos, my mom being one, wife being the other, and you. Great job on your videos. Happy holidays. What was the reaction to the Muslim series? Do you think there is a change in people's ideas towards Islam? So I did a Muslim series recently, you guys, for those that didn't see it. And the reaction is that was a hard one because I went into Dearborn, Michigan, which is primarily Shia, and I knew it was to some degree, but I didn't know it was like so majority Shia. Okay, so the representation wasn't. Look, you're taking 1.8 billion and you're trying to do a series on them and showing how they are. You could do hundreds of videos, right? Like hundreds of videos to get that story. And so I try to get different angles, but that's always going to make some people, you know, unhappy because they're like, I'm Muslim, but hey, what you're showing isn't anything like me. So, you know, they're going to take it personally, which is understandable. Like if someone shows something like, oh, here's what Americans are like, and I don't fit the narrative of what they're showing, I'm like, yeah, whatever, because that's not me. So I get that. I did get some of that. Some people are super happy. Whole mixed range, I would say, of people. But Muslims, I got to do, like, it was only one part of the United States. Like, that just is, I could go to different parts of the United States, different parts of the world. I've been in many Muslim countries doing videos. So just by default, it's sort of a Muslim series because it's Muslim people. But I feel like I just didn't go, I touched the surface that there's going to be a lot more in that to make a complete story. Okay. Yval asks, Peter, how about gentrification in boom towns? By boom towns, I'm guessing you mean, places by like, you know, popular cities. Is that what would you be saying? I just lost my, okay, you're still live. Good. I lost the screen here. Gentrification, I would say, I don't know. It's a double-edged sword. There's some places where it helps, you know, if a neighborhood gets safer because of it, you know, that could be looked at as a good thing. It brings in more jobs. But if a late neighborhood loses its soul and its feel and like the average person can't live there any longer, then it's, you know, there's a problem in that. So it's, that's a sticky one. I don't have an easy answer. I can, here, let me just, guys, apologize for this. I lost my stream. Let me get my wife down here. Natalia. Okay, I can't see your guys' comments, but I'll get that fixed soon. Hopefully she'll be down here. Gentrification, yeah, that's a tough one. You don't like to see a place lose its soul, and that sometimes happens. You like, you know, the world is changing so quickly, and certain neighborhoods, like when I was in Arthur Ave out in the Bronx, Italian neighborhood, you know, going through the stories of what the past was like and how everyone's coming out of everyone's doors and everyone's connected. It's sad to see that stuff go away. Love, I lost the stream, the comments here, and I don't want to end the stream.
Okay. And I'll figure it out.
Okay. So guys, if you haven't gathered yet, tech is not my thing. I use a GoPro. There's a couple buttons. One is power on, one is power off, and that's about all I do. So it was actually a barrier to start my editing, is worrying about that stuff. Like, how am I going to, you know, learn how to edit? Actually, it's not that hard. And my edits aren't complex or anything, but it's, you know, I wouldn't say my strong suit. Do you see where that thing goes? Guys, I'm still going to speak. I just lost your comments. Can I see on my phone, you think?
I think so. I'll give you my computer.
Okay, give me your... Okay, she's going to bring in her computer. I can look at the comments, guys. All right. Another question. How do I make money? Okay. That's pretty simple. It's just ad revenue. It comes through Google. So it has to do with the amount of volume as far as like how many people are watching, how long they're watching for, where they're watching from. So what ads are being presented to them. Some are going to be in markets that are more valuable for the advertiser. So that's going to pay out more. There's never a way of knowing exactly. Another thing is like videos that are evergreen. This is where I'm very fortunate, is someone can go into an old series of mine, say on Saudi Arabia, I shot years ago, and still watch that. And it's still somewhat relevant today. Whereas if I was a news channel, like I watch this news channel, Breaking Points, their content is all like, you know, time specific. You're not going to watch, you know, here we go. Okay, cool.
You just scroll up.
Okay, got it. Thank you. So you're not going to watch some news story from most likely 3 weeks ago. Like that's done, it's expired. And so that's the difference between my content, which is evergreen, and some channels that are not evergreen. They have to be, you know, time specific. So that has a lot to do with it. Thank God for me. I mean, like I'm very fortunate it works that way. So all of these videos sort of add up over time. You know, some are dead in the water, nobody watches them, but some keep going. I can shoot a video like that, you know, I did 2 years ago and it's still performing and doing something. So basically it comes through Google, and here I got the comments going. Thank you from Slovenia, excuse me. Great country, by the way. I love Slovenia. Beautiful. The little Switzerland of Eastern Europe. You're creating amazing content. Thank you. I appreciate it. Love Slovenia. Was there in Ljubljana a couple years ago, and in the north, the Taras or Tatas mountain. I forget the name of the mountains, but a beautiful place right near Italy. So the money just comes through Google, basically in a direct deposit every month. It's called AdSense. They calibrate it. I don't know. I forget what Google takes out of an ad dollar. Like, I think it's either 45% or 55%. The creator gets 45% or 55%. I forget what. So that's the mainstream of income. Then I have Facebook. My Facebook channel is actually bigger than my YouTube and sometimes performs much better. I had no clue that that would be a reality. I honestly just started reposting my YouTube videos on Facebook, and then that has the ability to scale larger on Facebook if something goes viral. So those two streams, I have a brand I work with, Cuts Clothing. You watch my videos, you've seen the ads. And what else? I have a Patreon. Thank you, the Patreons. I apologize, I haven't been doing anything for you. I'll do a video soon. But I have a Patreon group. That's a bit of money. That's it. That's how it works. I'm going to do some merch here soon. I just started. It's been a long process, I got to say. But a new website. And this is the part I wanted to get all the videos on here and make it super user friendly. It's easier on desktop, like all these things. But so if you go down to here, this map page, again, on desktop, it's really awesome. So you can get, you know, I typed on the part of the world, North America, right? And then you can go like to this, see all videos. Well, it's working, right? It's brand new. It's brand new. I'll get that going in a second. If you go there, you can see all the videos on the website. And you can press like newest or like oldest to newest. And if for those of you that want to see like the old stuff and how the journey started, you can go back to my earliest stuff. Okay, here it is. So you can just scroll. It works better on the desktop just because it's bigger screen. But if you go oldest to newest, stuck in Pamir Mountains, Mergab, Tajikistan, I was like 25, 26 years old then, just a kid. It was just like a very short video, but you can see, you know, where this there's a little hair going on there. I mean, the boat slips started early, but I was like 26 there. And, you know, these are sort of the raw adventures in Syria. This guy with one leg jumping down the stairs for me, really interesting. Muhammad Charlie was his name in Damascus. Interesting guy. Teaching English in Thailand. I did that. I lived in Thailand in my younger 20s, or like 26, mid-20s. I've done all sorts of things. So here's the travel TV show I was talking about, the teaser for. It's a three-minute video. It's actually maybe some of the best camera work because it was shot with a like real DSLR camera. So my point was the other revenue source is going to, I'll get some merch going. I don't expect to make any money off that, but I got my logo going and I might as well wear my own hats, you know, and some of my t-shirts and stuff like that. So that's the new logo and I'll be selling that stuff soon. So those are the ways I make money. It's a great model because before when I had my detailing business, if I had to make more money, I had to hire more employees, more insurance, more supplies. There's just so much more overhead. Where in this digital space, it's like, you know, if I can make the scalability is endless. If you know, if I make a good video, it can really scale out and doesn't change the amount of people working on it, which is my wife and me. So it's a model I was looking for a long time, to be honest. I was really burned heavily with my workman's comp insurance. It really pissed me off because this was last recession, 2008. It was in the state of Nevada. And, you know, I paid my workman's comp, never had a claim with any one of my employees. It was really expensive insurance. Did everything I was supposed to do. Well, the state went broke because of the recession. And because they had to borrow from the feds to cover their bills, they wanted business owners to pay more, like more than the insurance that I already paid and never used. They wanted us to fill that fund. And it just like burned me in a way where I'm like, oh, really? They can just do that? Like there's no, didn't even make one claim once ever. And I'm paying a crazy amount. That's like my business isn't making that much money. I'm like getting by. And now they're going to stack on a massive amount of money. Because of why? Because they didn't manage their books right. Okay. And then that just like sat here. So on the risk with this business model is the internet goes down, right? I mean, we're all sort of screwed at that point if we can't get online, but that would be the risk here. But that risk, I just saw too many physical moving parts with too many regulators. Like, I have no problem with regulation. I very much appreciate clean air and clean water and want things to work, and I have no problem paying for that. But when it gets to that, where it's like thievery, let's call it, because that's what it was, then I have a problem. So this model, for those that are, you are, you know, maybe some of you are thinking about getting online with something, if it's a scalable product, like, I hate to say the word product, it's scalable model, it's amazing, right? So that's the money part. All right, I'm going to get some of your questions here, guys, and then I will finish up by letting you know where things are going with the channel. How much do you make? You know, I'm from the old school. I can't say that. You know, I grew up, my dad was like old school New York, Italian style guy. Peter, you never tell anyone. You never tell anyone what you make. You know, you never let them in on that information. Maybe those times have changed. People are more open about that stuff, but I was sort of beaten down with that one. So can't tell you, but it's good enough to live now. It's not like I'm wealthy, but I'm happy. And it's very finicky with Facebook, especially. I got demonetized for like 3 months because of the series in Ukraine in the countryside. And when the kids go swimming, they have their shirts off and they're like little kids. And I got killed on that. I removed all those videos. I made sure I went back and blurred everything out in YouTube. So yeah, it's not stable, let's just say, but I just have to create good videos that perform well. Okay. Hasibadione. I'm sorry, I'm butchering your name. You should contact Shaikh Utman from One Message Foundation YouTube channel. I believe he's based in San Diego for a Sunni Orthodox view on Islam. Thank you for that. Thank you. Truth be told, I won't be, the Muslim series is going to be done for a while. I will get back to it eventually, but I've done 7 videos recently, and I've realized that, you know, for Muslims, they'll probably be happy if I did 40 videos, but for some people, some of my audience, they're like, all right, it's not their number one interest. And then I might start to be, you know, they're like, hey, let's, cool, we saw that. Now we want to see something else. So there's always a balance with that, guys. I'm trying to like deliver enough of a deep dive where you get something out of it. But with any of these things, you could go in, I could do Muslim videos for the rest of my life. Probably build a more like a bigger channel, because that's how YouTube works. If you really like go niche on something, and then I was like the Muslim video guy, then that would be beneficial. I would just burn out on it, like with any topic. That's why I like what I'm doing, is I can do whatever I'm interested in. I want to do this for the long haul. I don't want to burn out in a year or two. So to be able to go into all different walks of life and see it from all different angles keeps me interested. And so I try to get that balance right for you guys. It's not always possible. Another question I get all the time is, are you always traveling? And no, I'm not at all. I've gotten it down, pretty efficiently, especially these US series, where I'll go into a city for say 7, 9 days. And it's like full on 100% assault on making videos. Sometimes I'll do 2 in one day. But if I go, say, for 7 to 9 days, say I shoot 8 videos, that's going to last 2 months. So for those creators out there that are really interested in like the model of it, that's 2 months. That's 2 months of videos. So I let's just say 8 days, I'm in a place. So that's what I have to travel. Now it's stressful because I got to coordinate all this stuff. I got to find the right people. I got to figure out the right stories. I got to think of the right intros, which is to me always the hardest part, though it is getting a little bit easier with time. Good morning, guys. Today we're going to blah, blah, blah. It's like, I got to think of that to like bring someone in and then hope that the story really matches that, because sometimes they get totally off the rails and off topic. And then my intro doesn't even match what we got into. So try to like nail that down really well. So literally I'm traveling, try to do it once every 2 months. Yeah. I'm sort of at the, I've done a lot of traveling in my life and I'm married and I like the balance, to be honest. I like to go out full on, like crush it, adventure. It's very intense. And then coming home and having 2 months to edit through that and post the stories and do other story creation and development. Like right now we're working on the next series. And so you have to obviously set that up. It takes time and there's planning to it. All right, guys, a few more questions. Then I will end here with where we're going next. You might have talked about this, but what got you into the style of documentary? Okay, I did, Robbie. Thanks for chiming in. I'll go back about 20 minutes here when this is, we're an hour in. Go back at like the 30-minute mark. I gave the full story. It's a long one. Okay, how much, Mo asked, how much money do you spend when traveling? Mo, totally depends on the country. The U.S. is obviously more expensive than Eastern Europe. I've stepped it up a little in my hotels and accommodations. I'm not staying at the Four Seasons, but I'm not at the Holiday Inn. I don't know how the Holiday Inn, but the Motel 6. I'm not at the cheapest. I'm more in the more mid range now. More, you know, stepping it up a little. I think that's what happens when you get older. You want to, like, I want to be able to get a good sleep before every one of these videos. Like, I need to be on my A game and performing. Like, I need to be energetic, and so I've spent more in hotels. Plane tickets aren't usually that much. A rent a car, food. So each trip, I don't know, it depends where, $2,000-$3,000, I would guess. Something like that. Do you know what a super chat is? Seems like you're getting a super chat. Yeah, I apologize. I think I answered all the ones I have in here. I've answered the top chats. I see top chats. And I've answered all those, to the ones I've seen at least. All right, guys, if I missed your super chat, I really do apologize. I want to answer every super chat, obviously. But all I see is one at this point. I'm on my wife's computer now, and this is what's coming through. So I answered that one super chat. If there's any more that I missed, I really do apologize. It's not on purpose. Okay. Couple more here. Okay. What, Ahmed says, what countries are on your list to visit 2021? Like I mentioned earlier, Israel, Palestine, really want to get in deep on both sides of that story. You know, I try to avoid politics as much as possible with the content. Of course, you get dragged in because politics is life and it's almost impossible to avoid at times. And that one especially, right? But I want to get that story. As far as countries go, my wife and I are going to go to Italy on a trip, hopefully, when we can. So I might make some videos out there also. And then I don't have anything specifically nailed down as far as countries go, but probably in Europe, a country I would like to dive into, it's probably not going to be for a while, but a country I love is Indonesia and how varied and mixed up it is. I'm getting this wrong by like 1,000, but it's roughly 16,000 islands, 8,000 inhabited It's a country that I don't know how these archipelagos stay together with a centralized government, because you go to these islands and you'll be on one island and it's one religion and way of life. And then you go to the next one and it's totally different. And the people have very little in common other than apart from being human and, you know, wanting their needs met, but like their cultures are so different. And when you have so much of that, you know, you have Sumatra in Indonesia, which is a massive island, right? I think that would be more of a conservative Islamic place. And then you have places like Manado, Sulawesi. Yeah, that's where it was, Sulawesi. It's Christian, like the city's Christian, and it works there. And so the country is like so mixed up. It's really, I think, one of the big mystery countries out there. And there you go. There's the biggest Muslim population in the world. I think it's the fourth biggest population in the world after the US, I think so. What is it? China, India, US, Indonesia. That's what I'm super interested. Suhas, tell us about how you met Natalia. You guys are cute. Tinder, Suhas. Do you have Tinder in your country? It's not just for hookups. It worked. It created a marriage. So that's how we met. We met on Tinder. We texted back and forth. We connected. On all sorts of different topics, like we were talking about movies, and then, you know, we're attracted to each other. So we went out on a dinner. She ate at like one fork bite every 10 minutes. She was eating so slowly. It was killing me. But hey, we had a good connection, and then it just went from there. And I honestly thought I'd never get married. I know this sounds like it's not supposed to sound. I didn't see the value in it. I thought, you know, I look at most marriages, I'm like, yeah, 50% want to sign somewhere to get out of it. Okay, who's really excited about the institution? And so I didn't even think I would go down that road. I mean, it was a 50-50, honestly, and then it just happened. And naturally, it was the first time it just sort of happened naturally. And like, there was no resistance to it. And here we are a few years later. We still haven't had our wedding. How crazy is that? Because we got married technically during, like, with the government during COVID, and just haven't had a wedding yet. So honeymoon period still. Lorraine, thank you. Appreciate it. Lorraine is a big supporter. I always see her comments. Thank you, Lorraine. You're amazing. Motorfucker. I don't know. I apologize if that's not a joke. When I'm reading it from afar, I came up with something else. But Motorfucker from Switzerland. Thank you so much. From Sweden. Sweden. What am I talking about? Sweden. Thank you so much. Great country. I took the Viking lines from Stockholm to Helsinki many years ago when I was 25. For those that don't know, it's just this party boat. I think it was the worst hangover of my life. I was dropped off in Helsinki, and I fell asleep on a park bench. This is I don't drink anymore. I don't party anymore, but this is when I did. I had three Russian bunk mates and a ton of vodka, and we just fired it up. I don't think I slept that night. It was like this boat with like colored carpet. It looked like a casino and like glitter balls and stuff, and it's a boat where I think the young and old Swedes go back and forth. They'll like go to Helsinki and then come back the next day. I'm not giving you a great props about Sweden, because I did have fun on the boat. Sweden's an amazing country. What's Stockholm, like 14 islands or something? Beautiful architecture. Love it. Okay, Marilyn, thank you. Appreciate the support. Thanks for being you. Thanks for being you. Appreciate that. Mary, thank you for giving us such a diverse look at the world, yet making us also connected. Be safe from Miami. Thank you, Mary. That's what I'm trying to do. It's honestly, it's in a selfish way, it's keeping my sanity, because I do look at the news too, and I do get irritated with so many things, and you know, with how this world is going, and this is my sanity. So thank you so much. I appreciate it. In Miami, we're neighbors. I'm right up the coast from you now. Okay, Carmen, welcome on board. Okay, Carmen just joined. I appreciate it, Carmen. Thank you. I think I got through everyone here. If I miss someone, no, I got everyone. Okay. All right, guys. So future series coming up here. Here's what's on the radar right now. Native Americans. It's not going to happen, as I said earlier in the chat, live stream. COVID policies have been very strict on the reservations, from my understanding, and I'm just going to wait for things to chill. I really want to get this one right. I really want to get in deep on it, and I want to create the best videos and experience. So be patient with me on the Native Americans. That's probably the number one requested series, and I rightfully so. It's a very unknown group of people in this country for most of us. The reservations are like different universes, and I know very little about them. So I need to start my reading and get that set up. Like, unless COVID does another whatever, and they're getting strict there, if it relaxes, then I'm in. I'm going to get that series this year. Appalachia. That's on the radar. I want to get in deep into Appalachia, into those towns that have sort of, you know, not progressed with a lot of the other cities in the country, or, you know, I hate to say these words, like left behind, but some of these places where, you know, they've been left behind. You know, the jobs have moved out, the industries have moved out. And I want to tap into their world and into their heads and how they look at. And I'm sure there's both negative and amazing stuff going on at the same time, but it's a part of the country most of us know nothing about. And that's high on the list. I told you abroad, like Israel, Palestine is long, again, COVID stuff. I know Israel is very strict right now, but when they start to open up, that's high on the list. And then coming up here soon will be where we're going. We're going to Southern California. So we're trying to get in with this community out in Joshua Tree National Park, working on that, working on Slab City. It's sort of an alternative. I haven't done my research on it. I need to do the research, but it's sort of an alternative community living out the desert also. We want to get into motorcycle gangs. Now, this is not... it hasn't been the easiest. If any of you guys are in motorcycle gangs, please reach out. contact@petersantinello.com. I would love to. I need an in. A lot of this stuff, you just need an in. And I really want to get into, there's even a Sikh motorcycle. I don't know if you call them a gang or a club. There's a women's one. There's obviously the Hells Angels. I want to get into that community, you know, dive deep on, like, how do they look at the world right now? What do their thoughts say about COVID and restrictions and say America 2021, 2022, and get that perspective. So that's we're going to be filming. I'm going to be filming that in about 3 weeks. Yeah. And we'll start posting afterwards. So that's pretty much what is on the radar right now. There's a couple really big series in there. And there's a bunch of other little ideas. Like, sometimes I just come into stories like the guy hasn't emailed me back yet. Hopefully he does. I was out. You know, what I do miss about California is not the crime and the homelessness, but what I do miss is like the ability to get into a car and go into completely different areas, like go into the mountains or the desert. Redwood trees. And so I tried to recreate that the other day, and I drove out to Lake Okeechobee. It's that big lake in the middle of Florida. And on the way out, I was in the Everglades, and I stopped on the side of the road and I started talking to a guy. This guy lives out in the Everglades. He's got like a little island. He showed me pictures. He was off it, and you can only get to it by boat. And he lives in his own universe. He's got a pretty sweet house out there, but it's in the middle of the Everglades. So I'm trying to get that story. Hopefully he gets back to me. But any one-off stories like that, like, it doesn't have to be a series. It can be like a just some person's super interesting story that is not connected to anything else. So I think there'll be more of that too going on this year. All right, Sam, thank you so much. Appreciate it. JB, what were you, what city were swiping in Tinder that y'all met? Kyiv, Ukraine. Yeah, Tinder works. I've been on it for a while, but it works pretty much everywhere, I think. Farouk, thank you for the donation. Appreciate it. Very nice of you. And back to Mary. Mary, Miami Mary. What a great city that's turning into. Like it's gotten a lot better over the last couple of years, I would say. It's not like I know Florida well, but you can go down there and there's stimulation. There's some good restaurants. There's life. There's like a good energy going on. The driving, I have to say, is the worst that I've seen. Actually, the worst is Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, but the 95 from Fort Lauderdale to Miami is I'm not complaining. I'm doing it for entertainment value only. It's atrocious. It's so bad. You're doing like 90 miles per hour and someone will come up on you with like fenders hanging off the car because they hit like three cars earlier in the day, and like coming up so close, you just got to like get out of the way no matter what, because it's just like, you know, they're going to either cut you off or run into you. So that's been interesting here. All right, guys. Well, I think I got all the live chats. If I missed you guys, any of you, I appreciate it. This guy's laughing at Riyadh driving. Yeah, Riyadh, guys. Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. It's like you're out. Believe it, and you know, for those that everyone has their thoughts on Saudi Arabia, but if you're in Saudi Arabia and you're Riyadh, it's a pretty like rule-based, safe place. I just don't know what happens to those Arabs when they get behind the wheels of their cars in Riyadh and they lose it. They just go full gas pedal to the floor and it's like, it's just chaos. Bogota is bad too. Yeah, I agree. I've been there. That's pretty bad. All right. Where have you met the happiest people? Joe says, I'd say like a lot of like Southeast Asia places. I think where the climate is good, they never worry about there being a food issue in those places. Obviously not too poor to the point of not being able to survive, but enough means where they're, you know, I think they seem the most relaxed. I wouldn't survive there because I need to do more and need more action and to achieve more, and I like working. But a lot of those people that just have all those deep, deep family connections and ties, there's all sorts of bad stuff going too, obviously. But yeah, Miramar or Burma, I don't even know what it's called these days, but I haven't been there for a long time. That seemed like people were very, very happy. So, okay. Watch out for gators. Yeah. I haven't seen one yet. When am I doing a live event in Miami? Mr. Rodriguez says, maybe I'll do that. That's a good idea. How do you summarize 2021 from your experience? Well, good question. Look, we've moved four times in the last year and a half trying to navigate this thing. Well, one back to the States. Well, just with my mom for a bit before we got our feet back in San Francisco and had to move from there just because, no offense to anyone living there. It's, to me, it was always the best US city. At least it was my favorite. It went downhill so bad, and I'm not willing to wait the how many years it takes for it to come around. It will come around, I'm sure, but don't want to do that. So we're in Florida, and then we just moved up the coast a bit, in a more relaxed type place. So for me, it's just been a process of navigating policies and ways of life and where's best for us. So that's been interesting with 2021. As far as on a global level, that's a really deep topic. It could go on forever. Trends I've seen that are negative, like homelessness way up, mental health issues way up. There's a lot of fallout from this pandemic that we will, that we're already starting to see, but that will manifest more in the future. I'm saddened when I see kids outside in a mask, alone, you know, in nature, stuff like that. It's just, it's not, no matter what your take is on everyone's, it's a very touchy issue, obviously. But when it's just ridiculous, like there's no zero chance and someone's living in that much fear, it really saddens me. And I think there is a consequence for that. All the division, you know, politically, you know, that's, I do believe it's somewhat of a, I'm oversimplifying everything, but it's divide and conquer strategy. It's worked throughout history. And I feel like there are some forces at play that want to see us as society, somewhat weak and disjointed. And people can benefit from that. It sounds super conspiratorial, but that's my only quick way of saying it. So all of those things at play, I'm not happy about. The good point is, like I said earlier, is like a lot of the perceived reality is quite often worse than the actual reality in a place. For example, whatever video you see online or whatever news media you watch, you can, I haven't had problems connecting with anyone. It's not like I walk out and they're like, what political party are you? And I hate you or I like you. I'm not, there's like zero dealing with any of that. So this talk of, say, civil war in the US, I don't see it at all, because it's too much of a culturally mixed up place. There's no like defining lines necessarily. Like my neighbor could be, that one could be a Republican and that one could be a Democrat. And it's not like there's, I don't know. I just don't see it. I don't see it at all. So on the positive note, I don't think we're going in that direction. On the negative one, I just got to get through this pandemic, I think, and people need to get together. My wife and I have been going to Florida Panthers games, hockey games, and I grew up playing hockey. I'm not like a big sports guy, but she loves it. Like she's got the jersey, Bobrovsky jersey, the hats, everything. She's yelling, screaming, very sweet and nice and nicest person. But then you get her at a hockey game and she's full volume screaming at players and whatnot. It's great. But it's fulfilled a need, I think a need just to be connected with other people. And it's away from politics. We're all there to have fun. Hockey to me is the most beautiful sport to watch. It's like ballet in aggression in one sport. I love hockey. Haven't followed it forever, but we're following it this year. And honestly, it's just covering this need of like connecting with other people, you know, giving the high five to the stranger when you score, yelling together. It's really just being with a lot of people in a stadium, that energy. I think the more of that comes back into society, I think we'll like bring the temperature down a bit, hopefully. So that's my assessment of 2021. I have young people. I promised I wouldn't swear, because I promised some parents I wouldn't swear, because I honestly don't. I want to keep, you know, 7-year-olds to 70-year-olds on this channel. So 2021's been a shit show completely. Hopefully better times ahead. Most underrated country in each continent, according to you. Okay, I'll say Ukraine in Europe is underrated. Indonesia in Asia. Middle East. Iran. These are just, I'm rapid firing these. I'm not thinking through them. South America, Colombia. North America, I'm going to give the U.S. I think it's underrated. It gets it's the big dog in the world. There's a changing, let's say, of world order, and it won't be the big dog forever. Obviously, there's the rival, China, and China's in many metrics doing better or going in the right direction where we're going in the wrong direction. But it's always attractive, I think, whether that be sports or countries or whatever, is to just chip away at the guy that, you know, was in, I'm not saying leading role as far as culture or better than anyone else. I hate that stuff. But as far as America's place in the world, most information I find, especially when you're in Europe, it's negative about the U.S. I don't know what that's all about, to be honest. And there are plenty of problems here, and there's plenty of things to be negative about here. But there are some special, unique things here that I've tried to bring out in my videos and talk to you guys about. But for that reason, I'd say the U.S. is the most underrated in North America. What else did I miss? Antarctica, Australia. Well, Australia is Australia, right? That's from my understanding, they're not having the best year. So those are my ratings. Okay, The Beast. If everyone wants to cover other countries and get an in-depth view, send a few dollars because it's not cheap. All right, thanks, The Beast. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. All right, guys. I appreciate all of you. This is the end of the year recap. And thanks for coming on the journey. I'm super grateful for all of you. It's exceeded all my expectations and dreams, and I feel like I'm just getting started. This next year is going to be amazing. If you got any ideas, contact at petersantinello.com, or really interesting stories, characters, whatever. We go through everything that comes inbound. We can't get back to everyone outbound just because we're just two of us, but I do read everything. And that's it. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. Whatever you celebrate, enjoy the end of this year. Try to take some moments to reflect and, I don't know, remove the noise. And know that it's, you know, we're all being, on a heavier note, being played to some degree, I feel. And a lot of your perspective is a choice. So just guard that with everything you have. Watch my content, but watch other people's content. I'm only one angle in. I'm not going to get all sides of something. To be really well-rounded, try to go for people that are seeking truth. I think you all do. That's my number one goal in everything, is trying to seek truth. It's a moving target. What is truth? A lot of the times, my goal is not to push a certain agenda or a political party. Of course, I have my views, my ways of looking at the world. And but just say hi to your fellow man. Be kind to people. Enjoy your families, your friends. And have a great new year. Okay. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.